Welcome back to Sunday Morning Quickies, episode 50 for July 10th, 2022. What we have here is a Model 101 that came in from viewer Carol. Carol lives out in the Seattle, Washington area. And this 101 was made in 1929. It came out of a cabinet. It's going to be going back to her in a bentwood case. Now, I'm not a big fan of plugging something in willy-nilly, but I did look at these wires. They appear to be okay. It's all going to get rewired. But the power connector block has open terminals and screw terminals on it, so I put a piece of electrical tape over that. So I just wanted to see if the motor was going to run, which it does. It doesn't run well, but it runs. So I'm going to unplug this now so we don't take a chance of zapping anybody. So yeah, there's, as long as we can get the motor to turn, I'm pretty sure I can restore this. But here's a problem. This did not survive shipment very well. You can see how this got bent and this got bent. So with the heat and humidity of July in New Jersey, it's going to be less than pleasurable working in here. Shooting video with the, which entails having the fans off. So we'll keep that in mind. All right, let's turn her around again. And we'll lift the top off and actually remove this presser foot, make it easier to get everything out of the way. And here we go. You can see that those took a bit of a beating, but I can straighten those. I'm not overly worried about that. So we'll be okay. The mechanism is coming along nicely. It's freeing up, but you'll be able to see here, these gears are quite disgusting, and all this mechanism here still needs to be cleaned out. Part of the problem this machine has is in its wiring. You'll notice here, this is the wiring, this is where the motor goes in this spot here, but this is the wiring for the lamp assembly. Like the featherweight, these wires are encased in lead, which allow it to get pushed and put in position. I did a video a while back showing how to rewire the light socket on a featherweight and then add a stiffener to the two wires so you can position it much in the way that this lead sheath does, but without having the lead and its subsequent lead oxide issues. Now, the lead oxide is a problem not just because it's a hazardous material of one form or another, but it flakes off, as you can see here. And all that crap is getting into the gears and into the grease. And there lies the problem, because these are pretty precisely fitted gears. I'm going to lay this down a little bit. Now, I haven't pulled the light assembly off the machine yet, but let's pop these bottom, or at least this one bottom cover off. I'll show you another issue with having that lead in there. You can see all this crap that's laying in that access cover, that's crud from the lead, and you can see what it's done here. There's a gear in all that mess. Actually, there's two gears in all that mess. All this crud is going to have to be cleaned out. All this has to be eliminated, and it's going to take a bit of time to do. I'm going to wind up flushing that out. I'm going to take this machine outside After I get the wiring out of it, I'm going to take the lubricating spider off. I'm going to use a squeeze bottle and some kerosene to flush a lot of this crap out of here. I normally don't have to go that far as to using kerosene to flush, but in this case I'm going to have to. This machine is just that dirty. It's that much of a problem child. And I really, really, really want to get this nice and clean before it goes back out to Washington. This is going to require a little bit of body work. You can see how the top cover arrived. When this machine goes back, the top cover is not going to be installed. It's going to be packaged, or I should say it's going to be wrapped separately. The machine will be cocooned. The top cover will be wrapped and cocooned. I'm providing a bentwood case for this machine, and that will go in yet another package. So, yeah, the shipping is going to be a little bit more for this one, but we're taking real good care of this machine for her. The set screw that holds this portion of the lighting assembly does not want to give it up, so I'm going to use the handle from my Chapman. Get some extra leverage to get that started. And there it goes. It's going now. And pull that back. And you see this is going to be flaking off quite a bit as we pull this out. So I'm going to yank that here first. And then extract this out and around. And as soon as this gets out, I have got to go wash up, because I don't want this lead oxide all over my hands. All right, we're going to clean this table up. I'm going to get the vacuum out, vacuum this mess up, and I'm going to go wash my hands. Ugh. Now, on a lot of these 101s in the past, you find other things down here. This is underneath the hook area. I think the first 101 I showed you guys, this was loaded with pins, and, you know, straight pins, and actually a straight pin had gotten jammed into the gears here, and that's what was jamming the whole machine up. So, yeah, when you're doing a 101... they're nice machines and all, don't get me wrong, I really do like them. But geez Louise, are they... they got all sorts of places that'll trap crap. And this one is certainly pretty dirty.
Here's something you might not have considered doing. Once you've got the majority of the greasy crap off of the surface of the parts, of the gears, you can clean the rest of the exterior portions of the gear with the gears still attached to their shafts and still in the machine. I'm using a rotary tool with a small stainless steel wire brush to get the majority of the big crap off of these gears. I'll go back in later with cup brushes, small stainless steel cup brushes, and clean a lot of more of the stuff off of them. Now, basically, this is just slinging it around into that compartment. I'm still going to have to go around in there with swabs and dampen swabs with some sort of a cleaner to pick it up. I have discovered that the quick-drying contact cleaner that we use for electrical components works wonders to help pick up that crap.
Getting inside here and getting this crud out is essential on 101s, and it's not easy. Like I said earlier, this one was made in 1929. It has many, many years of schmoo buildup on it, as you can see, and it is critical to get all that old crap out before you put any new grease in. My initial passes are with a screwdriver, just picking up as much of the major crap as I can get. And once I get that off, I'll go back and get the rest of this stuff with swabs. But right now, I'm just literally scraping schmoo. I almost use a different S word. Scraping the schmoo out. Trying to get also a lot of this white lead oxide out at the same time. This machine is a mess. And like I said, I don't recommend doing one of these as one of your first machines. Do something that's a little bit simpler. No, do something that's a lot simpler. And wait until you have some experience clearing a lot of schmoo. Because this one is going to, this one will challenge your soul for getting it out. Now, I'm going to switch over to a brush. Let's see if I can get some of the smaller stuff with a brush now. An old toothbrush will work. I'm using a gun cleaning brush. Same concept. But once again, I'm doing it to knock crud down and work from a high spot down to a low spot. Like now I've got the machine sitting on her nose. So start at the high end of the machine when you're knocking schmoo off so it falls a little lower. You're eventually going to have to get it all out anyway, but you might as well not work against yourself. You might as well use gravity to your advantage. And use every orifice you can to your advantage for getting in and getting crap out of there. And just know that you're going to be sitting here for many hours scrubbing in many cases. Another thing I recommend you get is if you have a small shop vac in your workspace, particularly one that uses like an inch and a quarter hose, or if you have an inch and a quarter hose, you can get a kit. I got mine at Lowe's. It's got this cone, and then it has various extension pieces, and then it has brushes, and a little detail knob, and another extension, etc., etc., etc. You can get in there, and you can vacuum out a lot of the schmoo that's in hard-to-reach places. The kit from Lowe's, I think, was under $4. I wholeheartedly recommend, if you have a small... This is what you get. It's all card-mounted. It's like $4. I'll put a link below. So, I mean, you can go to your local Lowe's and get it. But at least if you look at the link, you can see what it's looking like. But that helps a lot for getting a lot of crud out of these machines. Particularly out of 101s. If you take nothing else away from this video today, besides the fact that cleaning these 101s is a pain in the neck, also take away the fact that getting the balance wheel off is not anywhere close to what you're used to if all you've done is like 66s, 15s, 99s, 201s, etc., etc., etc. First of all, here is what we're used to for a stop motion knob. Okay? It's got the protuberance that's threaded on the bottom. You've got the set screw, yada, yada, yada. What we have on a 101 is very different. We have the little set screw, and the first step, of course, is going to be to loosen that. Here's where the fun begins. This is coming off. You notice it's very different. Then we have the first of five washers. This is the stop motion washer. Notice it has both an inside and an outside tab. Then we have a series of washers, which I'm going to remove with a magnet. The first one that comes off has an outside tab. Next one that comes off has an inside tab. You see right there. one with an outside, and like the magnet might not pull that last one out very well. Let's see if like tilting might get it going. It's a real pain in the neck getting these out sometimes, and magnets are the best way of doing it. Well, that's not going to behave. No worries. We'll get it off when the balance wheel comes off. It'll come out. But here's the tricky part. This balance wheel isn't going to come off as easy as you think. There's actually two set screws. We have a set screw here, which I will loosen appropriately. And then rotate. And there's another set screw. I'm going to loosen that one up. Then, and only then, can we lift the balance wheel off, and we'll extract that last inner tab washer. Why did Singer make this so convoluted? Well, it's got to do with the clutch that's inside the machine that engages the motor. The potted motor from this machine has a worm. There's another ring gear inside the machine that the worm engages. And there's clutches with that. Another reason why I don't recommend having a 101 as your first project machine. What you should do if you own a 101, at least once a year, take your balance wheel off, clean the inside, clean the shaft where the balance wheel attaches, clean and degrease all the washers. I like to use a piece of Scotch-Brite pad. I buy the real big ones, and I cut it with a pair of utility scissors. Then I put a little bit of oil. In this case, I'm going to use a little bit of penetrating oil because that cuts the crud really well. And then I just use Scotch-Brite, and I polish up. Well, polish might not be the right word. I clean. I scrub-a-dub-dub all of these surfaces. Likewise, I get it inside here and I scrub all these surfaces because you want this to be able to slip on and spin nice and freely. Every 101 I have seen, including the two that I own, when I bought them anyway, the bobbin winder assemblies don't work correctly because the balance wheels are all gummed up. Or I should say the shafting for the balance wheels are all gummed up. And the only way you're going to make it so that when you loosen the stop motion, that the needle doesn't go up and down, is if you go through the effort to take these apart and clean them. While you got it apart, you can see this has got a lot of crud on here. What I'm going to do with this one, rotary tool, wire brush, and just get all that crud out of here at the same time. Don't be afraid to do that. Rotary tool, wire brush, clean the crud off of the parts. Likewise, off the, I'm going to use a cup brush and I'm going to get in here and do the whole thing. But don't be afraid to clean these up really well or take them to the sink with some, I would take the set screws out completely, but take it to the sink, scrub brush and Dawn. Clean it up really, really well. You will appreciate it so much more when it's clean and it's working correctly. And if you're doing it for somebody else, believe me, they will appreciate it. It's the last thing you want to hear is, oh, well, you know, I go to wind bobbins, but my needle keeps going up and down. You know, it's not supposed to do that. So make sure you pull the right amount of maintenance on that. And once again, while you have it off, now there's two screws here will remove the bobbin winder. This bobbin winder should look very familiar. It's very similar to the bobbin winder that's on the 201-3, or actually many of the 66s. If you go through the service manual for the 101, it explains how to take this one-way clutch apart. It involves removing this whole back piece, this bushing that supports the shaft in the rear, then loosening the set screws on this ring. It's kind of an involved process. I'm not going to do it on this machine service it really doesn't need it. The one-way clutch is working properly, and just lubricating it at this stage of the game, cleaning everything else up and on the surface and lubricating it is good enough. I am going to spend an inordinate amount of time getting all these gears cleaned, getting all this extra grease out of here, and I'm going to do all this cleaning from the outside, and it's going to be very time consuming and very messy getting all this crud out of here. But the reason I'm not taking that off and taking that one-way clutch apart is it's too easy to damage portions of this machine where, especially the casting, getting this rear bushing off, it's out of the question. I'm not going to do that. As long as the clutch is working fine, I'm not going to risk the integrity of the casting. And that's a judgment call you have to make with every machine you work on. There's always going to be something where you have to say to yourself, you know, self, weigh the possibilities, you know, do the rewards really exceed the risk that's involved? It's all a risk and reward type of thing. And honestly, the chance of damaging this machine by getting that one-way clutch out in the removal of the rear bushing, it's too great. I'm not willing to take that chance. If it was my personal machine, I might consider it, but not on a customer one. The goal here was to get the internal workings clean and working well, and working really, really well. And I can do that without disassembling that clutch and taking all that mess apart. So, like I said, you know, risk versus reward, I don't see the reward considering what the risk is to that portion of the mechanism. I'm pretty sure I did a video already showing how to do the components of the needle bar area of a 101. And if I haven't, I will circle back and I will do, when I get ready to do that on this machine, I will shoot this once again. But if you look at it, you can see that there is a lot here that looks a heck of a lot like a 66. The presser bar assembly looks very much like a 66, including having this this slack thread regulator coming across here, which actually in this case it's not really a slack thread regulator. That's where the slack thread regulator is on a 66. This is basically forming the stop for the spring on the upper thread tension assembly, but everything else looks so much like everything else we've looked at, you know, 66s, 99s, 201s. There's a lot of commonality here. So these components will clean up pretty much exactly the same way. Like I said, I'll go back through and I'll look, see if I actually did a video on this series. But regardless, when I get to that point on this machine, I will shoot that. Don't look for that in the next couple of days. I'm going to be spending a lot of time cleaning in between gears on this machine, so it's going to take me a while to get to that point. But there's so much other crud that needs to be busted on this machine before I worry about in here. But like I said, plan on seeing that again. Well, I hope you can see why I don't think that the 101 is an ideal beginner's project. If you've got two or three machines under your belt, yeah, you could probably do a good job with it. Let's do yourself a favor. Don't have as your first machine on your dance card if you're just getting started working on machines. Do four or five machines first before you go digging into a 101. These things are kind of complicated. Cool, make a great stitch, but kind of complicated. I'd like to do another live session pretty soon. I'm holding off making the formal announcement and starting the registration for it because I'm waiting for a piece of hardware to come in from one of my technology suppliers. I have a Cisco DX70 that I bought for this room. It's going to be mounted up where this 24-inch monitor is. and we'll be able to hook my regular video camera that I shoot my videos with into that as a second camera for the DX. So we'll be able to do a live session. What I'd like to do is I would like to do one specifically on a 66 or a 99 for the next session, just to go through the mechanism. That way I can put a machine on my fixture, shoot using the video camera, have that shooting the machine, and the Cisco has a camera built onto it, which will be facing this way, so I can be looking at the machine, talking to you guys, and having the other camera looking at the machine, and we can switch it back and forth. It should be pretty cool. Anyway, like I said, I'm waiting on a piece to come in from one of the suppliers. I have been trying for months to get this piece of hardware that I need. Unfortunately, Cisco is pretty much end of life the DX70. I own two of them. One of them stays on my desk next to my work computer because I use that every day at my day job. The other one I got specifically for in here. So as soon as I can get that part, get it in here, we can talk about doing a live session. We'll probably even do a demo of what a live session will look like so you guys can see that, because it's going to be pretty cool. Well, that's what I have for you for episode 50. Thank you all so much for watching, and we'll see you on the next one.